Welcome to the Facing Your Fears podcast, where we talk about facing the fears we encounter in education as teachers, students, administrators, and parents while finding our inner confidence to thrive. I'm your host, Amanda Alford, and today my guest is Katie Temple. Katie is a first-year teacher. She teaches fifth grade at Jefferson Craig Elementary School in Switzerland County. She went to the University of Kentucky, which, as I always joke with her and her mom, I forgive you for that. We can still be friends. But you were born and raised in Kentucky, so, I mean, that makes sense why you're a Kentucky fan, and I, being born and raised in Indiana, makes sense. But that is a huge rivalry, like, right here on the river, isn't it? Like,
it's very big.
I was like, the kids and everything like that, I mean, it's hardcore. You're either blue or red.
There's, yep, exactly.
And we're only in, like, we're closer to Louisville than we are to Lexington, and mm-hmm. Louisville doesn't even count. Like, you have L fans, you're either a UK or an IU. Like, there's no in between. So, well, thank you, Katie, for joining me. As I have started to like to do, I always like to kind of do like icebreakers or whiteboard messages, as I explained in my last podcast. And the whiteboard messages are messages that I put on the whiteboard for my students. And as I always say, I'm kind of the silly questions and the goofy questions that help kind of just build a relationship that the students like. So here are two questions that I have posted on Instagram, Facebook, gotten feedback, and so I like to ask my podcast guests as well. So the first one, if you could only watch one TV show for the next year, what would it be?
SpongeBob SquarePants. I grew up watching SpongeBob with my brother, and we still to today quote all the time. Or if we see something funny on like Facebook, we'll instantly tag each other. And so if there's nothing else on television, I always go to SpongeBob because I know that like I can connect with SpongeBob. Like, there's so many things where I just laugh constantly, and it just brings me back down to earth and like to my inner child, I guess you could call it.
There you go. I was like, and I don't know if this makes you feel better, but I did have quite a few students who also said SpongeBob, so you can definitely connect. But I get that because, I mean, that with your childhood, that's what you grew up watching. And so I had students writing answers. I think I had 17 students out of 100 write The Office. And I'm like, you weren't even, like, born through part of that. And it's just so funny. That's what they connect with. And I told my students, I think mine is NCIS Los Angeles. And I like the NCISs. And I joke with the kids. That's the only one that I've stayed committed to. Like, I watched the original. And when Tony and Ziva and Abby left, I left. I'm like, no, you can't be taken off the originals. I watched Criminal Minds until Derek Morgan left. And I'm like, nope, he's out. I'm out. And so I joked, I'm like, NCIS LA is the only one who hasn't killed off, like, main characters. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, I'm kind of committed to it now. It's been on mm-hmm. 10 seasons. And they're like, well, what are you going to do when that season ends or, you know, the series ends? Mm-hmm. I'm like, I don't know. Like, I really don't watch TV on a consistent mm-hmm. basis because we're always outside and we're active, you know.
I understand.
You've lived and grew up on a farm. Mm-hmm. We're out in the country. I grew up on a farm. Mm-hmm. And there's just not time to watch TV half the time. I mean, with the chores.
Exactly. It's hard to fit it in.
It is. So if I had to do childhood, I would do Scooby-Doo. Like, because that's what I remember growing up
exactly.
watching is Scooby-Doo. So your second question, and the one that I ask when I ask my students, if you could, what would you tell your 13-year-old self? And I always ask my students, what would you tell your 5-year-old self? Like, if you could go back to kindergarten. But since we're adults, 13 kind of seems to be that weird age. That's when hormones kick in and everything's just dramatic and changing and up and down. And you don't know how you're going to behave and you're trying to make decisions for yourself. So if you could, what would you tell your 13-year-old self?
If I could, I would probably tell my 13-year-old self that you're not going to be married at 24 years old. Go ahead and get that out of your mind. It's not going to happen because I'm almost 25 and I'm still not engaged. I mean, I have a very consistent relationship going right now where we're on the verge of marriage and everything. But so many other things happen before then that it's crazy. I mean, we've been together 5 years just about, still dating, not engaged yet. But currently we're trying to buy a farm. And so I'm like, you know, things are going kind of backwards. Normally you're supposed to maybe get married first and then buy a farm. But I'm like, you know what? What's more important right now? Like, my cows need grass. I gotta get some grass. So just understanding that and like, you know, I'm not gonna be able to plan every little thing out, you know. I guess when I was 13, I probably thought, you know, by this age, I'm going to have a wonderful job and be married and have kids. And I'm like, I'm right here now. And I'm like, I'm glad I don't have kids right now. I'm glad, you know, I'm not married right now just because I'm just now getting into my career. Right. You know, I'd like to get comfortable in that. I love kids, obviously. I work with them every single day. I would love to have them someday, but right now just isn't the time for me, and I'm perfectly fine with that.
And I think, because I work with 13-year-olds, I know you teach 5th grade and myself teaching 7th grade, so I have a room full of 13-year-olds all day long. They do think that way. They do. Mm-hmm. They'll tell me all the time, by the time I'm 21, I'm going to have this kind of truck, or I'm going to have this kind of job, and I'm going to be married, and I'm going to have this. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, guys, it don't work that way. But you can't tell a 13-year-old that at the time.
Exactly.
And I think I would tell myself at 13, because I posted on Facebook, one, braces are miraculous. Like, you, I was like, because I got braces on at 13, and I hated them because that was not the end thing. Like, now all my students seem to have braces, but back then that was not the end thing. And I think I would tell myself, braces are miraculous. You may hate them now, but you will be so much happier when it's all said and done. Spend more time with your grandparents, and ask more stories, because I think we take that for granted.
Definitely.
Because we think they're just always going to be around. And I only have one grandparent left, and I really wish I could have asked more stories and spent more time with them. And the biggest thing, and I try to tell my students this now, all the people that I worried about when I was 13, I pretty much did not worry about or think about or even remember them by the time I was 30. Mm-hmm. By the time I was 30, nothing stressed me out. And that kind of rule that if it doesn't matter in 5 years, don't spend 5 minutes worrying about it. Like, that would be what I would tell my 13-year-old self. Trust me, in 5 more years, none of this is going to matter.
Yeah.
You're like, it's not going to worry. It's not going to matter. And everything that at 13 I didn't think that I was going to get or didn't think that I was supposed to do, I'd be like, you do get it. You just have to be patient.
Exactly, yes.
Be patient. It doesn't all come at once. And I'm thankful for that, because at 22, I'm glad I wasn't married or that I had kids, because I don't think I was mature enough or responsible enough to be married or to have children. And if I did get married, we probably would have ended up in divorce just because we just weren't in the same right mindset. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was just too young, starting out, trying to get our career started.
Exactly, exactly. Just trying to get your feet underneath of you.
So, Katie, if you would, tell us a little bit about yourself and kind of your why in teaching. I know this is your first year, and you've grown up in a teaching home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had your mom in second grade, but kind of like, why? Why did you take that road and kind of watch your journey been?
Well, when I first went into the University of Kentucky, I actually went to major in biology because I wanted to be a heart surgeon. And I made it all the way to my senior year, beginning of my senior year. And after thinking about it all, I was like, I don't want to be stuck inside every single day of the year. I don't want to work crazy long hours. I didn't want to have to be woken up at 3 a.m., you know, different mornings to go, you know, do surgery right away. I wanted to be able to have time to spend with my children one day. And a big thing, I wanted to have my own farm. And I knew that if I was a doctor, I don't know if I would have had enough time to fit that in as well. And that was kind of a hobby of mine that I didn't want to lose. So after thinking about it a lot, I finally told my parents, and they loved it because the entire time I was at college, they said, I think you need to be a teacher. I think you need to be a teacher. And I'm like, I don't want to be a teacher, guys. Like, leave me alone. I don't want to be a teacher. But finally, I was like, yeah, I kind of agree. I'd grown up around kids my whole life. I've got 1.5 million different cousins, it seems like. And so I was always kind of drawn to them. So I just decided, like, well, teaching might be the thing for me. So I got into teaching, got accepted into the teacher education program at UK, did over 300 hours of observations at numerous different schools. I observed in the middle school, in a high school, elementary school, even here in Indiana, because a lot of those were inner city schools down in Lexington. And then for my student teaching career, I got kind of more into the country, but still kind of city. And I observed a kindergarten classroom first, fell in love with it. And then I observed a fifth grade classroom, scared out of my mind, but fell in love with it as well. And so once I heard, you know, that there was an opening at Jeff Craig, I immediately, you know, got my foot in the door by subbing constantly, you know, long-term sub, short-term sub, whenever I could get in, I was there.
Well, and like you were just saying, your mom was my second grade teacher. And so you, being the teacher's kid, I mean, that kind of helps see both sides of it, because I remember being in college and being in my teaching program, the kids who were like, oh yeah, I'm going to be able to do this, and had all these dreams and things like that. And after their first or second year of teaching, they dropped out because it wasn't what they thought it was going to be. Mm-hmm. You know, teaching is hard. And they didn't see all the prep work that took before the students came. Even mm-hmm. the student teaching really, I don't feel, still prepares you for the entire spectrum of what having your own classroom, because you still have that safety net of the classroom teacher.
Yes, and I agree 100% with that.
And so you got to see the whole behind the scenes. You know, how many papers did your mom have to bring home every night? How many hours did she spend lesson planning? You know, breaks and summer and all the professional development and all the extra stuff that she had to do, and the late nights with the dances mm-hmm. and PTO meetings and everything that college doesn't prepare you for.
Exactly.
You know, you got to see that firsthand, where, you know, most of us, even myself, you know, I did all the subbing and all the extra things, but it still wasn't until I got my first classroom that it hit me, like, it's all on me now. Like, I have got to do it, and the pressure. So kudos to you for choosing teaching, but I think you actually had a little bit of an advantage mm-hmm. because you had your mom and you saw all of that. Going into it, and you still chose, yeah, I'm still going to go for it, even though it's going to be late hours and it's going to be extra, but not heart surgeon extra.
You know? Yeah.
You know, we haven't yet to get a phone call at 3 a.m.
Thankfully.
Like, I need your lesson plans right now. But I did get a phone call last night at 9:30 about one of my students. And yeah. So you need to be prepared for that.
Yes. Yeah. There's been a couple, even, you know, first year going into it, there have been a couple times where it's late night and, you know, I still have parents, you know, emailing me, texting me, because I normally have a rule. I'm like, you know, please don't contact me after 7 o'clock, because I need time to spend with my family, you know, and just to kind of gather myself up again. But there's still times where parents do reach out, and I'm perfectly fine responding to them. I'm not like, no, it's past 7 o'clock, I'm not talking to you, because you never know. It could be an emergency. I mean, it could be anything. So you have to be available really at all times, no matter if you say, don't talk to me after this time.
Right. I agree. I have, you know, I try to tell my students, you know, 8 o'clock, because they're mm-hmm. a little older, mm-hmm. and I use Google Classroom. Mm-hmm. But, you know, last night, 9:30, I have parents calling me. I'm going to pick up, because if they're calling me at 9:30 at night, mm-hmm. there's a reason.
Oh, yeah.
And it wasn't that they were mad. They needed to, you know, inform me of some stuff
yes.
going on. And it's not just teaching. You're a counselor, and you're a part-time parent, and you're, you know, sometimes the janitor, and sometimes the nurse, mm-hmm. and sometimes a friend, mm-hmm. and sometimes a therapist. And
there's so many things wadded up in one. I completely agree.
You are. So, you know, being a first-year teacher, what would you say are some common fears that either you had going in as your first year, because I know we're finishing it up, or that you just heard or thought of as a first-year teacher in education?
The biggest thing when I was first starting out this year was the first day of school, because I had not seen that. Even though when I was student teaching, I student taught in the fall, I still didn't see the first day of school. And so I was like, what am I supposed to do the first day of school? And again, thankfully, my mom's a teacher, and so I've constantly leaned on her throughout so many things. And she was like, oh, you're just supposed to do this and this and this and this and this. I'm like, okay, that seems simple enough. So getting the hang of, you know, what to do on your first day, because they don't prepare you for that.
No.
They really don't.
No teaching methods class prepares you for the first day of school.
No. Another one of mine was classroom management, you know, keeping control of my students at all times, making sure they're focused so that we can get things done, that kind of thing. Coming up with a routine, even. I felt like once I got a routine down, then things would go a lot smoother. Even parents kind of worried me to begin with. Because, you know, when you're student teaching, yeah, you know, you go to parent conferences, you sit in on them, but they don't talk to you. They talk to the actual teacher. And so I was concerned about that. Working well with my team, I knew that I was going to be placed with two guys. I know guys can be a little bit more independent, which is perfectly fine. And so I was worried, how are we going to work well together? Are we going to work well together? What's it going to be like? And a more recent fear, honestly, going in, I think for newer teachers coming in, is protecting your students, because we hear of so many different, you know, shootings happening all over, and preparing them for what could possibly happen, and honestly making them understand why we do things and that this could possibly happen. And the kids, you know, they're young and innocent. They're like, why would anybody want to do that? And I'm like, honestly, I have no idea, but it's something we have to prepare for. And that's honestly the scariest thing, probably.
It is. I agree. Because even in seventh graders, I have students going, that's not going to happen here, right? Mm-hmm. Like, we all know each other. And I'm like, no, it still can. And, you know, I just got back from Washington, D.C. I went with the eighth graders on a field trip. And I was telling them a little bit about the different buildings. And I told them about the Holocaust Museum. And, you know, a little bit that I'd seen, because I'm trying to prepare them because they're going to go on the eighth grade trip next year. So I was letting them know, these are the things that you're going to see. These are the buildings you're going to go to. Mm-hmm. And every single class, they were asking, you know, we were talking about the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. Why? Why did that happen? Why would somebody even want to do that? And because here in this small town in our little country area, we don't see that. And so it's, you know, just a big why, like why they can't even fathom, because we don't see that type of violence. We don't see that kind of crime here, thankfully. Mm-hmm. And it is hard to protect the students when they're not aware of the dangers around them. And then to also piggyback on what you said, you know, we don't get really trained on the first day of school, and you don't get trained on how to deal with parents.
No.
Like, there's no teaching method class that teaches you how to deal with, you know, controversial discussions and parents. Mm-hmm. I totally agree with that. And I think even veteran teachers have that fear. Mm-hmm. You know, we hear about possibly a parent who is, you know, a little bit more aggressive or controversial, and we have a fear, like, how are we going to approach this individual, because we don't get that type of training. So how have you personally, obviously, faced these kind of fears? I know it's only been your first year, but what are some things that you have faced that maybe you didn't know about and that you've been able to overcome and work kinks out?
A lot of it, thankfully, I've been able to kind of rely on my mom, asking her constantly different questions, but not only going to her, going around to other teachers as well. Getting comfortable talking with my peers and learning about them learning about me, how can we work well together? And that's been wonderful, because I think our team is extremely strong. They constantly have my back. They're always like, come back, you know, ask me more questions. And I'm like, you're gonna regret that, but I will be back, don't worry. So they've constantly supported me. I've constantly gone to, you know, the teacher across the hall. I have Mrs. McGarvey directly across the hall. She's been a wonderful support system. Going even to Mr. Spores, you know, and talking to him. I've been in his office a few times, and if he has a concern, he brings it to me. Not like I'm in trouble, but here's what's going on. What can we do from here? Mm-hmm. And it's been a wonderful learning experience. To go with classroom management, subbing before even coming into the school is really, really helpful, I think, because I got to know some of the students in there. They got to know me. And I also learned that talking with the students about their behavior, why it happened, what their take is on it, why we shouldn't do that, I think that's helped tremendously. There was an incident a few months ago in the cafeteria where I guess our entire fifth and sixth grade were really, really loud and the teachers couldn't calm them down. And so when we got there, of course, they quieted right down. And so I took my kids directly into my room and I was very upset and they could tell that I was very upset. And we just had a big conversation. It wasn't a lecture of, you did this wrong, you're not supposed to do this. It was honestly just like a heart-to-heart conversation. Okay, why were you doing this? Why were you loud? And they were like, well, other people were being loud. And I was like, okay, what should you have done? And then we talked about why. You know, why are you not supposed to be that loud in the cafeteria? And I honestly made them understand the reason you're not loud in the cafeteria is because if there is an active shooter in the building and somebody comes on the intercom and says there's an active shooter, I said, if you're loud, you're not going to be able to hear it. Mm-hmm. I said, if you're loud, where do you think the active shooter is going to go first? To the cafeteria. And so it's really an understanding of trying to keep them safe and why are we not doing this? What are we supposed to do? Getting them to understand. And that's honestly been wonderful because I truly think they do understand it.
I think the biggest struggle some of our students have is that nobody explains to them the why. They're just, you know, their parents tell them, do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that. They've had other teachers, do this, don't do this, and so forth. But nobody's ever told them why. Mm-hmm. Why do you need to do this or why do you not need to do that? It's just yes, no, do, don't. And it's just commands. Mm-hmm. And so they're just like, why? If somebody could just explain it to me, then they would probably understand it better and then they would behave better. And that's what I do in my class as well. Before any activity, before any assignment, before any lab, I always explain the why. Mm-hmm. This is why we're doing it. This is why it's important to what we're learning. This is why it's relevant to what, you know, is happening in this classroom. Mm-hmm. And it's a night and day difference of how they perceive it because they have that understanding.
Yes, I agree completely.
So you've been building your confidence. What advice can you share to other first-year teachers or potential first-year teachers? Because they're getting ready to graduate here in just a few short weeks. We're going to have a summer flooding of interviews with all these brand new college graduates wanting to be a teacher. And, you know, what advice can you give them of, listen, if you're going to an interview, if you're going to be in your very first year and you've gotten a new job, here is some basic information to help you overcome your fears.
I think one of the big things is getting to know your students, you know, creating rapport and respect with them, them understanding you, getting to know you, and you understanding them, you know, not just looking at their profile and being like, oh, I have this person who is 12 years old coming into my class. No, truly understanding them. Because once you're in the classroom, the kids have so much faith in you. It's incredible. It really, really is. And I hadn't realized that before I actually got my own classroom. You know, now I look back on my class and I'm like, they're constantly looking to me to guide them, to protect them, to be there for them constantly. I mean, I sometimes get emails from my students. Hey, I'm not having a good day. Can we talk tomorrow? Sure. No problem. Come to me. Let's talk. Again with the counselor thing. You know, you're a counselor.
You're
a teacher. Another thing is going to your teachers. I think that's a big thing because going in, you don't know everything. And I knew that going in. I said that in my interview. I don't know everything. You know, I'm willing to learn. And that's been a huge thing, not being scared to go to them. But one of my former teachers, actually it was my kindergarten teacher, when I told her that I was going to become a teacher, she gave me advice. She said, be firm, but be loving. And I think that is such wonderful advice because you need to be firm. You have to, you know, stick to your guns kind of thing. Mm-hmm. You need to let them know that you mean business, but you also need to let them know that you're there for them. If they're having a rough day, if they're having a rough life, you're there for them. You can be that safe place for them and they will go to you 99% of the time. I guarantee it.
Exactly. And that's, you know, kind of the same philosophy that I try to carry in my classroom as well. Trying to provide that safe place for them because we don't know what's going on in their lives. We don't know what kind of day they're having. And they need to have that safe spot that they can go to and know I may not be able to solve any of their problems. I may not be able to, you know, take away their pain, but I can listen. I can provide them, you know, a safe spot if they want to cry, if they want to yell, whatever they need, because many of our students don't have that. They don't have that at home. They don't have that support system. They don't have that positive role model. And, you know, that's something else that they don't teach in school is, yes, you're a teacher. Yes, you're supposed to teach the curriculum. Yes, you're supposed to, you know, go through your standards, you know, have good classroom management. Those things are all really important, and teach them their ABCs in whatever subject you're teaching. But you're a role model. That is your number one goal, is to be a positive role model to show them, how do you respond when things go wrong? How do you respond when things go well? How do you respond when things don't work? And letting them see the positive, because at home or in the community or wherever they go outside of your room, they may only see the negative.
And I always try to keep things really light and airy. I always try to have fun. Obviously, today it was like dinosaur day, and I dressed up as Wilma Flintstone, had my orange hair and all. But in fifth grade, I feel like things start getting more serious, and a lot of the classrooms get less colorful even. But I have always tried to make my classroom bright and wonderful. And, I mean, even today, you know, we'll make groundhogs. We've made groundhogs for Groundhog Day. We've made cows and pigs before, and we hang them up on the wall just because I try to keep them young. I'm like, yes, they're fifth grade, they're growing up, but they're still kids.
They are.
And so I always try to, you know, keep things fun, have fun with them. I pick on them all the time. They pick on me all the time. But it's just, it's a lot of fun. So even if, you know, somebody new comes into the class, you're guaranteed to partially have a good time.
Right. And especially being a new student, that's, you know, helping them overcome their nervousness and their, you know, apprehension. Well, so thank you, Katie, for joining me today on my show. Thank you for listening to the Facing Your Fears podcast. If you like my show and want to know more, follow me on Twitter. My handle is @Alford_science. You can find my podcast on all the podcast apps, iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, YouTube. And make sure to subscribe to my podcast. Join me next Sunday for the newest episode of Facing Your Fears. And as the great Red Green used to say, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together. See you next week.